This is Rebecca from chemistryismyjam.com. In this video, we're going to be looking at orbital notation. Orbital notation is another way to visualize the location of electrons within an atom. On the screen, you have the orbital notation for oxygen in its ground state. We're going to take a look at what information we can get from this, and then we'll look at how you can write the orbital notation for any element. Each of the arrows on the screen represents an electron, and each of the boxes represents an orbital. Someone could quickly glance at this diagram and tell that there were two electrons in the 1s sublevel for oxygen. They could also see that there were four electrons in the 2p sublevel for oxygen. Now that you've seen an example of orbital notation, let's take a look at some of the rules that govern how you write orbital notations. The first rule is the Pauli Exclusion Principle. This says that electrons fill the lowest energy level first. In the case of oxygen, that means that the electrons would fill this 1s sublevel, then they would go to the 2s, and then they would go to the 2p. So electrons will fill the lowest energy level that's available to them before they go to a higher energy level. The second rule is the Aufbau Principle. The Aufbau Principle says that each orbital can hold up to two electrons, but they must have opposite spins. And we indicate that by having one arrow going up and one arrow going down. So within each orbital, within each box, you should have an up arrow and a down arrow. Keep in mind that even though electrons are very tiny, they are still following the rules of physics, which is why electrons need to have opposite spins within an orbital. An electron is a charged particle. It has a negative charge. So if you have one charged particle spinning this direction, it's going to create a magnetic field. Another charged particle spinning the opposite direction would counteract that magnetic field, which is why the Aufbau Principle says that these electrons must have opposite spins within each orbital. The final rule is Hund's rule. Hund's rule says that electrons fill sublevels so that as many as possible will have the same spin. This doesn't apply much to the s sublevel because each s sublevel only has one orbital, but it does apply to the p sublevel, and you see it here in our example for oxygen. Notice that in the case of oxygen, you have an up arrow here, and another up arrow here before there were any down arrows put into place. This was to obey Hund's rule. The sublevel was filled so that as many electrons as possible had the same spin. If you had said up, down in that orbital, up, down in that orbital, you still have the correct number of electrons, but you have violated Hund's rule. This is an incorrect way to do the orbital notation for oxygen. You should have as many up arrows in place before you put any down arrows in order to keep from violating Hund's rule. Now that we have seen some of the details about orbital notation, let's take a look at some of the tools that you have in place when you need to write one. First of all, it's important to know the number of orbitals that are in each sublevel. So I have that listed here. You should know that an s sublevel always has one orbital. So anytime I draw a 1s sublevel, I'm going to have one orbital. A p sublevel always has three orbitals, so I would have three boxes. D should always have five, and F should always have seven. So this is a key piece of information that you need when writing an orbital notation. I find it helpful whenever I'm writing an orbital notation to start with an electron configuration. Here I have the electron configuration for oxygen, and this is like a roadmap that I can use to help me write my orbital notation. When I look at this, the first thing that I see is the 1s sublevel. From the s, I know that I need to start with one orbital in the 1s sublevel because an s sublevel is always going to have one orbital. And then I see this superscript that 2 tells me that there should be 2 electrons within that 1s orbital. So I would have an up arrow and a down arrow. Then I would go to the next spot and I see that I have a 2s sublevel. The fact that it's an s means that it should only have one box. And then there should be 2 electrons in it, one going up and one going down. The 2p sublevel comes next. P has 3 orbitals, so I would have 3 boxes. I've labeled it 2p, and I need to have 4 electrons in that sublevel. You should always draw your electrons one direction first. I always draw my up arrows first. So I would have an up arrow here, an up arrow here, an up arrow here. At that point, I've maxed out my up arrows. Now I can go back and put a down arrow. I have obeyed Hund's rule, the Aufbau principle, and the Pauli exclusion principle by doing things in that order. Here is an example where we are going to be writing the orbital notation for the element phosphorus. Keep in mind, you should start with the electron configuration for phosphorus. Here you have the electron configuration for phosphorus. I do have a previous video in this playlist that goes over how to write an electron configuration. Now that we have that in place, we can write our orbital notation. So I'm going to go step by step, left to right, through my electron configuration and draw it out as an orbital notation. The first thing that I see is 1s2. The S tells me that I should be starting with a sublevel that only has one orbital. So I'm going to start with one box. I'm going to label it 1s, and then I see that this 1s sublevel should have 2 electrons in it. So I'm going to have 2 arrows, one going up and one going down. I now go to my next place, which is 2s2. It's still an S sublevel, so it gets one orbital. So I'm going to have one box, I'm going to label it 2s, and then it should once again have 2 electrons in it. The next sublevel that I see is a p. Well, a p sublevel should have 3 orbitals, so I'm going to be drawing 3 boxes. I'm going to label the whole thing 2p, and then I'm going to fill it up. It should have 6 electrons. That's going to totally fill up my p sublevel. Even though I'm going to fill it up, I still drew all of my up arrows first because that's going to be a good habit for me to be in so that I don't ever violate Hund's rule. Then I drew my down arrows. There's 6 arrows total. I'm now ready to go to the 3s. The 3s is an s sublevel, so it only gets one box. It gets 2 electrons, and now it's full. And now I'm ready to go to a 3p. Which should have 3 orbitals. So a 3p is here. Here is where Hund's rule could easily be violated. I need to have 3 electrons in that 3p sublevel. I'm going to draw all my up arrows first. So an up, an up, and an up, and I'm done. That is the correct way to write the orbital notation for phosphorus in the ground state. If I had written up, down, up, I would have violated Hund's rule, and this would be an incorrect answer. There are some different variations of orbital notation out there, so I wanted to take a minute to show you one of those. You will see that these still follow all the rules that we looked at. They still follow the Pauli exclusion principle by filling the lowest energy level first. They still follow the off-ball principle by only having 2 electrons in each orbital with opposite spins, and they still follow Hund's rule by putting as many electrons as possible with the same spin within a sublevel. However, it does look a little different. Notice that instead of boxes, the orbitals have been illustrated with lines. They mean the same thing, so each line represents an orbital, and each arrow represents an electron. The other thing that you sometimes see is instead of being straight across the way we were doing them, sometimes they're on an energy graph. And so you can see that the 1s has the lowest energy level, then the 2s, then the 2p, then the 3s, the 3p, the 4s, and the 3d. So in order to follow the Pauli exclusion principle, you would need to start with the lowest energy level at the bottom of the graph and fill these sublevels as you go up the graph. That concludes Unit 2 about the atom. If you have found these videos helpful, I hope that you will like them and subscribe to chemistryismyjam.com.